is Veronika Romashkina, and today I want to talk to you about functional programming, specifically learning process of functional programming, why one should do that, and how to do the first steps in that direction. In this presentation, I will use a few code snippets just to give you some a bit of a flavor of functional programming, but don't be afraid of that code. I will explain necessary details, but you don't need to understand all in functional programming at this moment. So let's start. A few words about myself. I'm a functional programming enthusiast, and I have experience of working in many different functional programming based companies and applied Haskell functional programming language as a backend language for web applications in different areas. I also used functional programming in frontend with languages as Elm and PureScript. Besides that, I do a lot of open source work. My friend and I created an organization called Kovainik, where we do a lot of projects and libraries, applications with functional programming as well. I also love writing tutorials, guides, and blog posts about the topics that interest me and to help people understand functional programming more. I also mentor people who want to get into functional programming. There are also a few big projects I participated in. It's Google Summer of Code, where I was mentoring people working on the project specific to Haskell. I also participate in Hacktoberfest each year, and our organization, Kovainik, is also provides opportunities for other people to join and grab some tasks and issues and try to resolve that. And we as maintainers help them in this process with giving our review and some tips. And another big project, the latest one, is Learn for Haskell. This is an online-based course for learning Haskell functional language. I will cover this a bit more later on. So we're speaking about functional programming, but what's actually functional programming is? Functional programming is another programming paradigm. It's different from the most common one, object-oriented programming paradigm, which probably most of you are currently using as the most common and mainstream languages nowadays are object-oriented. So to understand the difference, I usually love to think about these two concepts, two paradigms, in the following way. Imagine OOP as some box with some buttons and arms, and all the processes are hidden inside. So what you do, you just push some buttons in different order to get something that you want to do. In functional programming, is a bit different. Imagine the conveyor, like here, and we have a data on conveyor, and we need to apply different functions to that data to change something. So here you see a lot of tubes that represent those functions. And the thing about functional programming is that you see what is going on. You can change the positions of different functions, put your tubes other way around, and compose that in this way. So it's very composable things that you can manually do. Additionally to OOP versus FP, there is a declarative and imperative programming paradigms. I need to mention that imperative paradigms is usually used in OOP languages, while the functional programming languages, most of them are using declarative paradigms. To explain the difference between these two, imagine these two situations. In imperative functional programming, it's like being a film director. You need to get everything done by you, and you decide. You tell actors and some decorators what to put where, what to say, where they should sit, what they should tell. While declarative, it's like writing a book. You sit and write about all that stuff on a higher level. So you can say in declarative programming, she was sitting at the table thinking about past. And that's it. For imperative programming, the director should be settle the scene with a table, with a chair, with the actor sitting in the right way and making the right face impression to somehow explain that what's written. If talking about functions and programming, the more visible example is when you need to filter your list. In declarative programming, you say, take this list and give me only even elements of the list. And it will do that. In imperative, you actually need to say how to do that. You say, take this list and each element you need provide what to do with it inside. So as you see, it's very different in many ways. So you can ask a question, why should I bother learning something so different from what I used to? Well, this is a really good question. And the answer is a bit complex. There are lots of reasons. First of all, learning something so different from what you usually doing is very, very useful for your understanding and for your self-improvement as a developer, as an engineer, because as you saw, we need to actually think differently, and this is usually good for us, as it will open more doors in the future, more opportunities, and will wider our mindsets. Also, functional programming is very good in particular tasks. So you will be able to make a better decision when deciding what architecture to use in that situation. And it will help you to become a better architecture and engineer as well. Okay, so also a functional program actually everywhere or already. You see this number of different programming languages on the screen, and not all of them are functional by design. Some of them were created as functional languages, but some of them are just natural OOP languages, but they are getting some of the elements and concepts from functional programming. You maybe heard that, for example, recent addition to Python is pattern matching, which is one of the elements of functional programming. So you see that functional programming is seeping into all other languages. Also, I need to mention that actually functional programming is used to create other languages and compilers for them as well. So why you probably always hear that learning functional programming is difficult, and why is that? Let's find out. Making a simple query in Google asking what functional programming is, you will receive a lot of very controversial things. For example, here you see functional programming is bad and functional programming is the future. It's better than OOP and it's dead. So it's very controversial, and this is because the difference of the paradigm it's based on. It's different thinking, so people are not sure how to adapt to that and how to use that. it will require some time to adjust to these changes in your mind and to adjust to different way of looking on things and thinking. Another reason why it could seem difficult is the lack of resources for new starters. This is the problem of functional programming, probably because there are not that many people in the communities that could make that. But this is also because the lack of the resources in the first place. So we get to this cycle that we need to break in order to all become better. So let's look into functional programming more closer. Now, there are a lot of concepts around functional programming. Let's just highlight few of them, very important ones. First of all is purity. Purity means that the function doesn't have side effects. By that I mean it doesn't read the file, which can throw an exception when like there is no file or the process of reading was interrupted. Purity means that every function does exactly what's in there and nothing more. What you see is all there is. Another concept is higher order functions. As you can imagine, functions are the main central basis of functional programming. And here we use functions as the input for other functions. This means that we can write a smaller pieces of function and move them around and compose it efficiently and elegantly. This helps to think about the function and evaluate them more clearly and easily. Another concept is totality. Totality is a very important one as it tells us about a function a lot. It tells us that at any input, the function should return us some reasonable output. It means whatever you put into that function, you will get the result. There won't be any runtime errors because of some corner cases, for example, for division on zero. No, totality means that on each and every input, you will get something right. And this is guaranteed. Immutability is in functional programming means that you have variables and you give it some value. And this variable will always have this value. It won't ever change. In order to have, for example, add 1 to that integer you have in X, you need actually to create another variable and call it, for example, Y and assign to it X plus 1. This means that for us as developers that we won't be affected by global variables. This is especially useful when writing concurrent code because you won't get any unpredictable or unexpected things happen to your code. Another one is algebraic data types. This is a very, very, very important and nice feature to have typed function. Many functional programming languages are typed, and this system will help you to build your application in the best way you can, because it makes it very flexible to avoid a situation when you can represent wrong structures or wrong results. And pattern matching, which I mentioned before. This is a nice feature for developers because it allows you to match on the input that you get and act respectfully to the situation of what you get as a pattern. Okay, this is not all of the concepts of functional programming, just some of them. There are much more, but this one are already shows some benefits and some powerful features of functional programming. And now I hope that you are a little bit excited about functional programming, so you want to start learning that. But there are so many functional languages, you don't know what to choose. I can help with this one. I suggest choosing Haskell. Haskell is a purely functional language, and it's very canonical in functional society. It has a lot of features of functional programming that is represented in there, and you can feel all the power of functional programming in this when you use this one. It also gives you a lot of other benefits to deal with, and it's very important for new coming to the languages to have that. But the other importance is that it's so much different from the language you get used to. So after Haskell, you would be able to get into other functional languages easily as well. So what Haskell benefits we have? Of course, it's statically typed system. Haskell has very, very nice compiler, which can help you with type inference and everything else. It's very powerful, and especially when you start your first typed language, it's quite important to have some helper to help you to be oriented in all these types. Pure functions by default. I already talked a bit about pure functions, functions that don't have side effects. This for learners means that you are able to control the code you write, you are able to test it easily and debug much easier by default. Important refactoring. This is very easily done in Haskell with the help of compiler, GRC, and other tools. And also, concurrency is super simple and composable in Haskell. I will show a few examples of the code just to demonstrate you all of these features. Let's start. Let's talk about composability a bit more. I need to mention that Haskell is lazy by default language. What does that mean? Strict languages, they evaluate each expression when they have it. Doesn't matter will they use that later or not, they will evaluate that. In Haskell it's other way around. Compiler won't evaluate anything, at least unless it's used anywhere, so unused code won't be even considered. This actually not a bad thing, and it can help you. And it helps with efficiency and optimizations, which is quite important for performance reasons. Now I will show you example of a function which takes a list of strings and should give us an answer if there is a string with a length bigger than 10 in this list. We will see examples both in Python and Haskell, and we'll talk about differences in these two implementations. For that, we need to start writing a few helper function which will help later to construct the final function that we need. So we start with getting the lengths of strings. We take a list of strings and get the list of integers. You see that in Haskell and Python, the code quite similar to each other. They both use mapping through the list with the function of length, len in Python. So you actually already see how functional programming is seeping in the Python way of writing code as well. Another function that we need is functions that could tell us from that if there is an integer bigger than 10 in the list we have at the moment. So you also see that it's also quite similar in here. In Python, we even see the word lambda from functional world, and we are doing mapping on the list in here. Okay, we have all that we need. Let's write the final function. And this is where the different came from Python and Haskell. In Python, this final function will need to get through the whole input list to first get the lenses. And only after that, it will be able to say if there is any bigger than 10. In Haskell, we are using compositions, but it will work more efficiently because of the laziness. It won't get through the whole list of elements. It will go only until it gets the answer. If, for example, in the list of 10 elements, the third word in there is bigger than 10 characters, then in Haskell implementation, this function will consume only first three elements and then instantly give you the answer that there is such an element. So it won't even get further. Because of that, in Haskell, it's very easy and actually more interesting and useful to write smaller functions and composite, as it will be optimized rather than writing one big function and customize that for all the situations that you need. Another example is concurrency. It's very expressive in Haskell and actually very understandable how you write that. First example, when we need to download two images and we need to do that concurrently. So here you see the type, we get two URLs and we'll return a pair of two images. And you see that we are using concurrently function here. And that's all. This function inside, it handles all the things that you need to think about when working with concurrency. But here you just use that function and give it the actions that it needs to do concurrently. And that's all. Another example, if you want to download an image, but if it will take too long, you want to give something more, something else as a result. And the type of our function is also telling us what's doing. It takes an URL and it returns either an image or the text. We chose text to represent the situation when the download took much more time than we expected. And here inside, we use another function, race, to do that. So we tell race these two actions that needs to be done, but the first one to finish will be our result. So quite easy, and you don't need to think about a lot of details that usually are very scary when you think about concurrency in other languages and generally. Okay, that's all cool, but does anybody actually use Haskell? Because if the language is not used in any production projects or anywhere, so probably we don't want to use that as well. The answer is yes. The recent surveys actually in the language showed that Haskell is used as a language to build the application in very, very different areas. It's healthcare, it's fintech, it's web, it's also mortgages, it's insurance, and much, much more. Also, I want to highlight the best things that created with Haskell is different DSLs, smart languages, it's command line tools. Haskell is also very famous for parser combinators, which is really useful for making parsing fast and smooth. And also you can write compilers in Haskell, and actually lots of nowadays and modern languages have their compiler written in Haskell. Also, what's important for web application is that Haskell is concurrent and multi-core language. For us, for developer, composability and expressiveness could mean a lot. As you work in the teams, it will be very helpful to have a language which eases your job. And also, all of us want to write an elegant code, and this is also doable with Haskell. Besides that, big companies actually chose Haskell to write some of the functionality for their products. For example, Facebook or Standard Chartered Bank or Galois. Even Google have some open source projects written in Haskell, which you can just check out in their organization as well. Okay, this is nice. And I hope at this moment you have a little bit curiosity about how you can actually start learning that. And let's talk about that. My first go-to thing to start in Haskell is the course, online course, Learn for Haskell. Learn for Haskell is based on GitHub platform. So it has four modules, and each model provides you information about functional programming concepts and give you the task to do to understand that concepts. Tasks are in Haskell language. The good thing is that it's absolutely doesn't assume that you already know anything about functional programming, and it will help you to understand it better through the course. It also contains all the necessary information that you need in order to understand the basic of Haskell. And other feature is that it provides mentorship in reviews. You can submit a PR for each of the module of this course, and mentors will help you to with your questions or to understand how to improve your solution, or even give you some tips and tricks for the future, which is quite handy for learning. We were doing this project during the Hacktoberfest last year, and actually the results were very impressive for us. We didn't expect that. We reviewed more than 500 PR in months, and more than 200 people tried Haskell that month with this course. Of course, this was very useful for us as well, as we gather feedback from those people and try to improve the way we teach Haskell and the way we present that information for absolutely newcomers. So we grab together all that feedback, and here are some tips and advices I want to share with you as well if you start learning Haskell. Ask for help. This is the most important one. The recent questionnaire about learning a functional programming language showed that half of the people didn't ask any questions and anything from anyone. They just experienced all that difficult path on their own. And this is shouldn't be the case always. You can ask your questions and ask on the platforms that's specific for asking questions, or just go to the community chatting platform and speak to people in there, ask them what you need to understand, or just tell them what you learned, because it's easier to understand when you explain to other people who are aware and see if your understanding is right. As an option, you could find a mentor who will help you with all of that. It would be a person who will go with you through all this process, as it's very important to get the feedback on thing that you do. And of course, you should practice a lot. Practice, practice, practice. You can either start a new project with new language with Haskell, or you can even take your some old tasks that you solved with different languages and try to rewrite that to Haskell. It could be really helpful as well to understand the difference in approaches and how you handle different things. You can use open source for that as well. There are a lot of projects and maintainers out there who have very nice projects, and they're really welcoming, and you can help them with the project, and in return you will get their support and their reviews, and they will help you with some tips how to write and structure Haskell projects. And I will suggest to participate in the community. It's very important to know where the language is going, what's going on with the trends in the community, what's used for different application, what libraries do they have, what don't they have, so you are aware of everything. And also you try to attend the events and meet more people from the community. It doesn't matter on which stage and level of experience with Haskell you are. It's always good to just come to some meetup or conference, even if you haven't started learning a language, but want to, just to see the atmosphere and to get some new thing. You can even use this experience in your own language that you are using nowadays. Okay, let's summarize that. Learning functional programming could be tough, yes, but at the end you will become a better developer, a better engineer, so it will worth it. I prepared a list of resources that you can check out now and try Haskell to see how it works, how it looks for you, and continue your journey into functional programming later. Thank you so much. This is all from me. Here are my contacts, so you can approach me anytime with any questions, or if you decide to learn functional programming and you want to discuss it or anything else, also please don't hesitate to approach me there. Thank you so much.